Okay, so good morning, everybody. Just want to give a short introduction to our next speaker. I think you all heard of Google Analytics, and you probably all know some problem with this approach. But as a website owner, you still want to have some information about your customers or about your about the people visiting your website. And Konark is working for a company. They developed a solution that enables to get a privacy-friendly web tracking for your visitors on your website. And he's now giving you a short introduction to it and in the whole topic of privacy by design and how to design privacy-friendly software. So give a warm round of applause to Konark and have fun with his talk.
Good evening, everyone. Welcome to my talk, Collecting Data in a Socially Responsible Manner. As Unicorn introduced, my name is Konark Modi, and I work as an engineer with a company called Cliqz. We are based out of Munich. Not sure if you've heard about Cliqz or not. Cliqz is basically a full-fledged search engine, and currently we have an index for Germany, and we're expanding to other European countries. Apart from that, we also have a lot of privacy and security features like anti-tracking, anti-phishing, and we package all these features into a browser. We call it Cliqz Browser for all platforms, iOS, Android, and all desktop platforms. And also, we have an extension which you can install on Firefox. Right? But I'm not going to talk about Cliqz here per se, but in the next 30 to 35 minutes, I'm going to talk about how users are being tracked on the web. We'll see some real-life examples on how users easily lose privacy to third-party trackers like Google Analytics or Facebook. But the whole point of this talk is not to criticize the current industry standards of data collection, but also see how we can create an alternative in which, without tracking the users, we can still provide the same services that these trackers are providing. So let's say, who collects data on the web? So who collects data on the web, right? There are two ways. One, when you're visiting the web, let's say you visit booking.com. Booking.com, as a first party, will collect some data. Totally legit use case. And then booking.com will also add some other third parties for other purposes. And what happens is when you visit booking.com, these third party, these different organizations, get information that some user visited booking.com, right? As a matter of fact, in one of the studies we did last year, we called Tracking the Trackers, we found out that 78% of the page loads on German web are tracked by third party companies, right? And we'll see in depth that they are not only being tracked, but they can potentially also know your browsing history and in some cases, who you are. Now, using a third-party service, there is a legit use case. One, you want to track how your website is performing. Probably you want to engage more users on the website. And with the advent of software as a service, it has become far more easier to just pick up a service, put it on your website, and start measuring what is happening on the website, right? That's primarily how you end up using a third-party service. But what happens is these third-party services rely on something what we call as server-side aggregation. So what that means is they will collect all the data, send back home, then on their backend servers, they will run some MapReduce jobs, which will then give you the desired output. Right. Let's say if you are doing an analytics use case, they will give you the desired output of number of unique visitors. But as a privacy side effect, what happens is they will also be able to track where all on the web have you been, and again, who you are. In the sense, they can track your interests, they can track your demographics profile, and create a complete digital persona of yourself. I'm going to share a real-life example that happened with Cliqz and a company. So last year, as I mentioned, we have one of the products, which is called Cliqz Anti-Tracking. What that does is, it does not block third-party calls, but it detects that a third-party call is taking out a personal identifier. So we will just mask that personal identifier, but let the rest of the call go. So what happened was, we got a call from a company, let's say company X, and they said, Cliqz Anti-Tracking is creating problems with our data collection system. We are not trackers. we are service providers. We provide analytics, audience measurements, but we've started to see that Cliqz is causing troubles in our data collection system. So we were like, okay, let us go back to our data stream and see what we are doing. Maybe there is a bug in our system. So we went back, we saw, and then we replied back to the company X. And we told them that, hey, you are actually tracking. Look at this data dump that we are giving you. You exactly know that this particular user visited 20 different web pages in a span of time. And this is who the exact user is. And this is tracking. But then the company said, hey, but we are not tracking. It's just that we don't collect that. We collect it, but we don't save that data. You can read our privacy policies. But in a nutshell, what is happening is the companies want to perform analytics and audience measurements, but the way they collect data, tracking comes as a byproduct of it. And that is what we want to eliminate. So what we suggested then was, let's meet, let's have a couple of meetings. We can show you an alternative approach based on which you do not need to track, and you will still be able to do whatever use cases you have. So we had a couple of meetings. We showed, demoed them all the use cases that could be solved without server-side aggregation, without tracking of the user. But then there was radio silence. Neither did they implement what we suggested, nor did they ever call us back. The only thing that broke the radio silence was they sent us a cease and desist letter that Cliqz is malfunctioning our data stream system. So there is a cease and desist order. But that's beyond the point. That's a story that keeps on happening, right? But at the end of the day, at Cliqz, we said, okay, let's find out the reason why that company, even though knowing there is an alternative solution to tracking, did not implement the solution. So we came out with three hypotheses. One hypothesis was that the company was actually interested in tracking the user, right? They were lying about their business use case, and their actual motive was to collect information about the users and do some sell it or use it for other purposes. The second hypothesis was they are not concerned about the privacy of the user. Between privacy and convenience, they chose the convenience. So because if they had to implement our approach, they would have to change the way they are collecting data, and they did not want to do all that stuff. So they chose convenience over privacy. And the third hypothesis, which actually forms the base of this discussion, this talk, is probably we were not successful enough to explain them what our alternate approach is and how they can use that alternate approach to collect data in a more responsible manner, right? So assuming it's not the first that they're intentionally tracking the user, but the reason is we were not able to explain it, we decided to write a full-fledged clone of Google Analytics based on our approach of client-side aggregation, which does not track any user, does not send any user identifier out from the client side. And we have a fully functional Google Analytics clone, right? We published how we created that, and we published a paper in a conference last year in Montreal called Big 2016. Then earlier this year, we participated in Mozilla Global Sprints, and we kind of open sourced this whole project as well so that community can take a look at it, give us feedback, and maybe we can contribute and see what other use cases can we put in this demo, right? And now I'll explain that what that approach is and how you can benefit from that approach, apply it in your data collection streams, and make the data collection more responsible. Let's take a look at data collection 101, like what's the very fundamental way of collecting data on the web. You have a website, and you have a requirement to measure audience on the website, right? These are like the seven basic things that anyone who owns a website, a blogger, a fully product-oriented company would like to do. They want to know the unique visitors. They want to know time spent on the page. They want to know the source of traffic, right? And instead of writing your own analytics system, you would say, I would go to company X and sign up for their analytics and just put that script in my web page, right? So now what happens is Alice visits your website. This website has a third-party script from company X, which will trigger a unique ID generation and send back home that there is a user with ID A, and the user visited your website, let's say hotel.com, right? Then there is another user B the same thing happens, visits your website, hotel.com. When the user B visits, when user Bob visits your website, you will generate another stream, which will say, B visited this website, hotels.com. And then you will run a MapReduce job, which will then give you the output that on hotels.com, for a given day, there were two unique visitors, right? What you actually forget is, there are other websites also who are using the same service. So what will happen is, when user A, Alice, visits another website using the same web service, on the back end of Analytics X, they will be able to see the complete stream. That Alice not only did go on hotels.com, but also they went on bill.ee. And then they will run a MapReduce job, show the owner of hotels.com their view of dashboard, and owner of bill.ee their own dashboard. But as company X, they will know the complete stream. So let's see what happened in this particular example. This pattern of data collection is referred to as server-side aggregation. What that means is, all the data is sent back to the server. On the server, they will do aggregation per user. You can treat it as a simple query like group by user and timestamp. And then they will give you the desired output. In order to perform server-side aggregation, the records must be linked, right? And for records to be linkable, they have to be a UID. And to generate that UID, they could use simpler techniques like just a cookie, or they could use more shady techniques like canvas fingerprinting, using what kind of fonts you are using, and things like these. That's beyond the point. The point is, to do server-side aggregation, records must be linkable, and to link the records, a UID needs to be sent back home, right? Now, based on the exact same data, you can do counts, which was the primary use case, but now the company X can also do profiling and retargeting. And that's how, when you go on bill.de or some other website, because company X knows that you had visited hotels.com, most likely they might show you some ad, right? And that's how the data can be misused. So the original purpose of the data set was to count uniques, but then the company can misuse that data for another purpose like profiling. And this method is bound to produce privacy side effects. Like in this case, not only did the company X learn where all did the user go, but also can able to retarget the user based on the websites you have visited, right? I'll take a more realistic example, Google Analytics. The reason for choosing Google Analytics is not that we have something against Google. The simple reason is, I hope everybody is familiar with what Google Analytics is and what are the use cases, right? In the same study that we did last year, Google Analytics has the ability to track you on 50% of the page loads on German web. That's the presence of Google Analytics on the German web. By definition, Google Analytics does not have any service where a user could go, give an ID, and list down all the URLs they have visited, right? There is no service that exists. So there is no reason why Google Analytics should have all the URLs. Third, which is like an arguable point, Google Analytics actually is better in terms of privacy as compared to other trackers. It's not 100% good, but it's still better than other trackers. As an example, Google Analytics does not use cookies. What that means is, it does not have a long-term user identifier. The identifier is short-lived. And we'll see what kind of parameters they use to uniquely define you. And then, they also try and sanitize the URLs that you send back home. Now, you could argue that since Google Analytics is doing so much for the privacy, why are we taking the case of Google Analytics here? But the point is, Google Analytics also relies on server-side aggregation. And I'll show you examples that any service which relies on server-side aggregation is bound to produce privacy side effects. Let's take a simple case. There is some user in the world. The user visits Spiegel.de. Spiegel.de has a Google Analytics tracker, right? Along with a lot of parameters that go out in the URL to Google Analytics, we will focus on only two parameters. One, the IP of the user, and other, the viewport resolution. Viewport resolution is the resolution of your browser, And for a short amount of time, it is pretty stable. So you could fingerprint the user on it. Then the user decides to order some food, goes to foodora.de. Foodora.de also has a GA tracker. And along with other information that they send, they also have lat long, the address you ordered food for, and the URL itself. So that also goes to Google Analytics, right? And considering the same points, same IP and same viewport resolution. Then the user goes to booking.com, checks for the hotel voucher that the user just bought. This is like a private page, but again has a Google Analytics script embedded, which sends the information out that the user visited the secure.booking.com, time, IP, and viewport resolution. Then user visits, let's say, Imgur, goes to Twitter dashboard of the user, and then goes to a flight booking, right? I'm sorry, I don't know what's happening with this. And then goes to the flight booking, right? Now this itself sends what URL did the user visit, the timestamp, the viewport resolution, and the IP, right? Now if you look at, this is the data stream that would look at Google Analytics backend. Now at this point itself, you can see that based on these two parameters, Google Analytics can potentially see the different web pages and different domains that the user has visited, right? So potentially the user can be tracked across the web. But also if you focus on the last two URLs, Google also can know who the user was and other PII sensitive details like my passport number, my date of birth, my email ID, my phone number, the people I travel with, and all that stuff. So let's take a look at this guy. What happens is this particular URL can only be accessed by me. So it's a dashboard of twitter.com. So analytics.twitter.com/username is the structure, right? Now this dashboard can only be accessed by me, not by anyone else, right? And now what happens is even this page has a GA tracker. And then when this data goes out, it has my username in it, right? So GA can potentially know that based on the history of these viewport resolution and IP, this user was Konark Modi, right? Then the second more haunting case is this case of flight booking. This is actually my flight booking. And when I clicked on the link, I went to the page to see change few seat preferences. And then I realized that there was a call that went to Google Analytics, which takes the complete URL back home. Anyone else who gets access to that URL can just copy paste the URL and they will give them the same information which I see as my booking, right? And the information that you see is, let's start here. The information that you see is trip details, when am I traveling, my booking reference, my email ID. So they say that email ID is masked here, but if you do inspect element, they have it in plain text on the HTML itself. My phone number, which is again plain text. Then they say, do you want to edit your passport details? The user, if Cliqz, can access the passport details, which tells on the right side my name, the packs I'm traveling with, in this case it's my wife, my gender, my date of birth, my passport details, my nationality. And this page does not only have Google Analytics, but it has a lot of other trackers, right? So if you are wondering that this case is very specific to Google Analytics or this flight or Twitter Analytics dashboard and Google Analytics, you are wrong. And at this point, not only did I lose to Google what all different pages did I visit, but Google Analytics now potentially can know who the user was and all my other details like my passport number and etc. Like, in all fairness, we don't know what Google Analytics does with this information. Most likely when it reaches their backend, they drop it, right? We assume that they drop it. But the point is, as long as the server-side aggregation is needed, these privacy side effects will always incur, right? We also do not know whether Google Analytics uses the same combination that we saw, the IP and the viewport resolution. But what we know is, they are definitely using some combination of parameters to solve their use cases. Let's take an example of, again, counting unique visitors. Given that this is Google Analytics backend and they are not using combination of any parameters, assuming the user does not go through a proxy network, so this is what the data will look like on Google backend, like web pages, timestamp, and the IP. Solely based on this information, Google Analytics cannot answer the question whether four people visited this page or it was one person visiting the page four times, right? In order to even solve this basic use case, they have to somehow identify that these entries came from different users, like in this case, by attaching viewport resolution to the IP. And now GA could answer the question that these were four visits by three unique visitors, right? Now, although with this given set of information, you will solve the basic use case. I wanted to know unique visitors. Google Analytics will give you the correct answer. But what has also happened is the same set of data could potentially be used for tracking you across web, right? And this is a big, big privacy concern. If you think that these were the only five pages that are doing it, take a look at a different stream, right? You can replicate the same by opening your favorite websites, open the network tab, and just take a look at it, how many trackers get loaded on each web page that you visit. For example, on your dating profile, which is a logged-in profile, there are some n number of trackers. The book I purchased, this is again the books I purchased. If you open and copy-paste the URL, you can see the books I purchased. Again, it has a lot of trackers. And basically, based on all these parameters, they can create a complete digital profile. The original use case that they wanted to solve was unique visitors. But now the potential they have is much, much more. And this is what we call as privacy side effect. And this is what we want to replicate with client-side aggregation, to not give the opportunity to the backend to manipulate what data they collect. Furthermore, imagine the same data stream being accessed by a third party that you do not trust, the third party you never even heard of. Like in the study we did, we found a tracker named Double Pimp. If you do a whois on Double Pimp, you would not get any information. But it was coming out to be a tracker in the long tail of trackers on the German web, right? Companies constantly update their privacy policies. It's something which is not unknown. So even today, if they are not using this information to profile you, maybe tomorrow they change the privacy policy and again start doing profiling on you. Imagine if government comes knocking on the door of the company and subpoenas it to submit the data streams. Government can see the same data stream and find out what is your activity on the web. The original use case was unique visitors, but see the damage and the extent of damage that could be done in this way. So this brings us to an important question. What can we as technologists, developers, and hackers do, right? One of the easiest answers is we should stop collecting data altogether, right? Let's just stop data collecting altogether. But we beg to differ. In this digital age, data is imperative. To create meaningful and useful services, you need data. But you do not need to track users to create those services. What will happen is if you stop collecting data altogether, you will break the wheel of innovation. Companies like Cliqz or other companies will never exist. And what will happen is the companies who already have the data, they will not be at loss, right? So now let's recap a little bit. We saw that the problem is because the industry standard of data collection is collect all you can and then run jobs per user on the backend, it will always have a privacy side effect. So let's for a moment think, if we move the server-side aggregation to the client-side aggregation, that means instead of creating user profiles on the servers, we start creating the user profile on the user's device. In this case, let's say browser, right? Now, you would argue what's the benefit of creating a user profile on the browser and not on the server. One easiest benefit you can see is the user can then know what kind of data about the user is being collected by what service. The user profile stays on the machine of the user and they can want to delete it, they can delete it. If they want to stop it, they can stop it. But the point is the user data should never leave the user's machine. If you want to do any aggregations, do it on the user's machine and only take out the aggregated data. Is it possible to do that? Let's take a look how. Let's say now we want to implement a Google Analytics clone, but based on this client-side aggregation, right? So what we will do is, we will say we will leverage the HTML5 local storage. In all browsers, in all modern browsers, you have access to local storage, so you can store permanently store the computations that you do, right? Then we will say, we will load a script, but we will load that script inside an iframe. Why in an iframe? Because iframe is a sandboxed environment. So and the script inside the iframe will not be able to access the main document. So the script, if wants to turn evil, cannot do anything evil on the main document. Second, the way main document will communicate with the iframe is through post message APIs. So only when the site owner wants to communicate with the third party tracker, only then it can send a post message API. So even the site owner has control over it. And third, because everything is now happening on the local storage, the user can inspect, modify or delete if it's not needed. So coming back to the same example of counting uniques, let's follow what will happen in case of the green tracker, the Cliqz green tracker, and what will happen in case of the normal GA tracker. So the blue side on the left side is what the Google Analytics script in the browser and in the backend will do. And on this side is what the Cliqz green tracker proposes to do. So the user visits the webpage spiegel.de/xyz. It will load a third-party script. On the right side, it will call GA. On the left side, it will call, let's say, test1.collector.com. And then GA will generate this data stream, spiegel.de/xyz, with the combination of IP and viewport resolution. On the right side, we will do something different. We will not generate a complete message, but we will generate two messages, URL and visit, URL and unique visit. And on top of it, we will open a state in the memory that is called, that will keep the hash of this URL along with the timestamp. This will help us count unique visits. And now what we will send back home is visit and unique visit. That's it. You don't need to send any other combination back home. While Google Analytics still sends back home whatever it was sending earlier. And now if you do a MapReduce job on the backend, you will still get the same answer. There were one unique visits and one visits in total, right? Now let's say the user visits the same website again in a span of 10 minutes or 20 minutes. Now what will happen is, So the script loads again. Google Analytics will still generate this message. We will again generate these two messages, visit and unique visit. But instead of sending the unique visit message, we will check our local state that we had sent a unique visit message in this time frame. Hence, this message is not unique. So we will drop that message. The only message that we will send is a visit, right? While Google Analytics sends the complete message again. While Google Analytics still sends the same message again. And now, if you run the MapReduce job on the backend, you will still able to get the same counts. Two visits by one unique visitors, even in case of Google Analytics, one unique visitor with two visits, right? So we are able to solve the use case of counting uniques based on local storage. Now the approach that I showcased removes the need of user ID on the backend. But even then, there are ways in which your data streams could have private information. For example, the example of Twitter Analytics that we saw, right? In this case, it was carrying back home my user ID. Now let's say everybody adopts to Cliqz Green Tracker approach and starts using it. Now this is what the backend for Cliqz Green Tracker will look like. Twitter.com, this is a public page. Then the user did a search about my data, again a public page. But then you see, hey, this is a private URL on the backend, right? It's problematic. It is problematic, but it's not as dangerous because you don't have an explicit UID on another column. So you can know that this particular URL was visited by Konark Modi, but you cannot know that these previous URLs were also visited by the same user. The only way to know that is if you send the data in a batch from the client side, so you batch all your 5 requests on the client side, then you send them back home, then on the server, you can see that these requests are coming as one request. That means all these events happened on the same machine. And that's the only way of tracking you could do if you're not careful about removing implicit IDs. So implicit IDs are actually application dependent. They do not compromise the complete history of the user, but that does not mean we should not rectify them. In able to rectify them, you need to run complex set of heuristics on the client side itself that determine whether a URL is clear enough to send back home, or this URL contains some private information that we should drop on the client side itself. Again, another example of losing privacy of a user is through referrers. Now compare these two data streams. These come as two different events. In the first event, you don't know whether which user visited this page, right? Anyone can visit Twitter for MRMCD, right? But if you attach a referrer which says that this page, twitter.com/MRMCD, was visited by this user, now it's explicitly clear that this page was visited by me, right? Again, it's a bad thing to have in your data, but because you do not have any explicit ID, because of dropping it on the client side, you will not compromise the complete stream. So you have to be even careful the referrers, mask them and sanitize them whenever you're collecting data. But again, this would be one particular event in your complete data stream. You will not be able to compromise the user's history on the backend, right? So, So these are some points worth mentioning, which we call like a good practice whenever you implement any data collection stream, right? You should not have any kind of identifier, be it explicit, implicit. You should always respect the DNT setting of the client. In my opinion, when you set a DNT setting in your preferences, we should drop the data on the client side itself rather than appending a header and sending it back home that the user has a DNT setting. Then because it's based on local storage now, so it's pretty open. You can go and inspect the local storage and see what kind of data has been collected about me. Now you could argue that counting uniques is a very trivial use case. What's beyond that? And to answer that question, we have an open source version of Google Analytics clone, which is hosted on this particular GitHub repository. You can go and check the probe script, which sends the data back home. It's actually just 200 lines of code. What it does, unique visits, page loads, returning customers, goal conversions, inside click-through, basically all the bread and butter of Google Analytics, but without sending any UID back home and still accomplishing the same tasks that Google Analytics script would do, right? Same way, you can access the paper. We have a small GitHub repository for the complete project. So it gives you a backend as well. Let's say if you want to host it on your server and test it on your website, you can even do that. If you do not want to try it on your own systems, we have a demo website. So you could go there and see what kind of data are we sending back home. We also give you a very basic dashboard on it. It's not super fancy, but it kind of conveys the message that we are trying to convey. If you visit this particular webpage, which is your footprint, it will actually tell you from your machine what data did we collect. And if you want to take a look at the messages, what are the complete messages that we send home, you could take a look at this this URL. To be honest, Cliqz has no plans to become an analytics service. We have a lot of other features that we are focusing on. And this primary approach was to demonstrate how it is totally possible to do analytics and other purposes without carrying back home a tracker ID. So you could feel free to fork the repository, play around with it. If you think you have more complex use cases and they cannot be solved by client-side aggregation, please contact us. We will be happy to know. We will be happy to solve them for you. But there is no plan to have analytics service like cliqz.analytics.com or things like these. But the primary purpose is to educate people, website owners, third-party services, that there is a way to do what you want to achieve but without tracking the user, and making web as a safe ecosystem altogether. Now, if you think that there is no production service that is running this, it's just a prototype or it's just some ideas written on paper, then I would like to point out that Cliqz has been using client-side aggregation for more than 2 years now. And all our features, which are completely data-driven, like search engine, anti-phishing, anti-tracking, news recommendations, are built on top of this data that is collected. And it is free from any kind of UID. It follows the same approach of client-side aggregation, and it is totally possible to make usable and meaningful features for the user without tracking the users. Again, if you want to take a look how we solve our use cases, feel free to go to our open source projects. We do open source a lot of our projects that we do, which are running in production. So you could take a look at the use cases. We often also try and publish our technologies in terms of white papers or blog posts that tell that what are we trying to achieve. So you can take a look at that as well. But the whole idea is that we've been running this client-side aggregation on more than 2 million plus users for the past 2 years, and we don't see a reason why other use cases cannot be solved using the same approach. You don't have any UID. You do not have to worry that you will lose customer data, even if you get hacked, and you are in a much, much more cleaner spot. And you only solve one use case at a time, so you don't have to even worry that this data set could be used for other purposes. Let's say Cliqz tomorrow decides to become evil and try and use the same data set for other purposes. We cannot do that because in our data streams, we cannot link two events together. In our data streams, we do not know whether the five messages that we see are from the same user or from different users. So that's the kind of impact that you will have if you focus on moving the server-side aggregation towards the client-side aggregation. That's pretty much it. Thank you. Questions, if any, sure. So the question is, how can we prevent techniques like fingerprinting based on IP or fingerprinting based on canvas, based on the Cliqz screen tracker approach, right? Now the thing is, going back to the initial slides that I showed, what is the need of generating a user ID, right? The need for generating a unique user ID is so that you are able to record link records on the backend to solve your use cases like doing unique visitors, right? Now, if you are able to solve the same use cases, you do not need to generate a UID, and that's the whole point. But you have a valid point that even because the calls come directly to the backend, based on IP, we can still fingerprint, right? That is true, but we also have some prevention mechanism, at least for the data that we collect in Cliqz. Before any data reaches our backend, we route it through a set of proxies that are not owned by Cliqz. So that means even if Cliqz wants to fingerprint using the proxies, using the client's IP, we cannot do that. But it's a valid question that how do you protect it in a general sense. So there are ways to do it, but not in this particular use case. So the question is, given that GDPR will be enforced next year, does the backend systems change and things like these? The problem is the companies have become so used to doing the way, doing data collection that they are doing right now. It's very hard for them to change immediately. I mean, it looks simple And it is once you develop the solution, but it requires a change in the mindset. The current mindset is to do everything on the back end and not on the client side. And that mindset, first of all, needs to change. Given what will happen when the GDPR exists, I'm not an expert on GDPR policies, but what I know from working on the web for quite some time, companies always have a way out for things. For example, I can share my own example. The Twitter case that I showed, that analytics.twitter.com was losing username to Google Analytics. I reported it to twitter.com in their privacy bug. The answer I got was that we have opted out of Google to share data with other Google softwares, and we also enable an option to anonymize the IP. And what it does is it only anonymizes the last octet of the IP. So that's the answer that I got back, and they closed the ticket. Similarly, I also opened similar tickets with other forums. Sometimes they patch it, sometimes they don't, but they will always give you some legal answer that based on the privacy policies, we are not doing anything wrong. And as I mentioned, privacy policies can change whenever they want to change. So even when the GDPR thing will come, you would not start to see changes overnight. I mean, you can already see how privacy policies are slowly adapting to it. So if you take a diff of last 6 months of privacy policies for any company, you would start seeing that these companies have started to change privacy policies to incorporate some information or the other. But if I expect or we expect that companies overnight will start collecting data based on client-side aggregation and not on server-side aggregation, I think that would be something foolish. The question is, how do we ensure that the client side does not send URLs which look private on the back end? Like, is there some kind of a list that we maintain? If yes, then how do we know a list? So one approach that we always take at Cliqz is to not go for a whitelist, blacklist approach. What we try and do is we try and use things like heuristics and machine learning to find out the patterns of data. Right. What that means is you would probably drop more data than required, but we always believe it's better to be safe than sorry. So as an example, I can show you the code as well. It's also on the open source repository. We have a function on the client side that is called isSuspiciousURL. What that does is isSuspiciousURL is drop long URL and function like these. What basically they do is they try and look at the path structure of the URL and try and detect whether there is a hash in the URL, whether the URL has a lot of parameters in it, whether one of the parameters looks different than the other, and things like these. So based on a lot of heuristics, we will decide whether to carry that URL back home or mask it or drop it altogether. Even so, and obviously, I mean, you cannot get right on day one. So it is a continuously iterative process. So even if we see or a user complains that, hey, this URL is getting leaked from my machine, although we haven't heard a case yet, but we identify that on our data stream, first we will kind of drop that data from our backend system, and then we will try and rectify what kind of heuristic failed and go back again to the client side and patch it. Probably I'll take the questions offline. I'm still here, so if you have more questions, happy to discuss them.